Hello everyone, my name is Audrey Carlo and I am Scientific Marketing Manager here at Stago headquarters within the Global Marketing Team. I am here today to talk with you about ST Genesia and the scientific studies obtained already with the device after almost 3 years of commercialization. We can divide the published results into four main categories. The first one, reference values, then anticoagulation, patients with bleeding disorders, and then finally, patients with thrombotic disorders. To start with reference values, a first paper was published by Professor Angelino Scherer and our team on showing the reference values for healthy adults as tested with ST Genesia using SCG thromboscreen. So these are the results you see here, showing a difference between male and female and an impact of oral contraception, and for SCG bleed screen as well. Again, quite an impact of oral contraception and gender. Their conclusion showed exactly this, that they were able to determine reference values for their use in the clinical lab, and that after this evaluation, ST Genesia was apparently suitable for their clinical practice. And they also conclude, as I said earlier, that oral contraception influenced TG parameters. Another reference values publication we have is the work done by Professor Mully and Professor Dufis in Belgium. So they showed some results about anatomical performances and the thumbal stability after freezing using the STG drug screen on ST Genesia. And here is the results they obtained on 42 healthy adults, showing the reference range they've been able to obtain both in absolute and normalized values. Then the third main paper we have on this topic on healthy adults is the poster that was shown at last ISTH, establishing reference values on 117 healthy donors on using the three kits, STG bleed screen, drug screen, and thromboscreen. And again, it was possible to see how the reference range can be variable from one activator to another. So you cannot apply bleed screen reference ranges for thromboscreen measurement, for example, and that gender and oral contraception were affecting the results. Then moving to children, we've done a work also with the team in Reims and Professor Nguyen. And along this study, so they included quite a high number of children, healthy children, and over the 299 of all individuals included in the study, we were able to see that thromboregeneration and, for example, EGP was somehow constant throughout childhood. So we know that the developmental hemostasis changes the results depending on the age, both for procoagulant and anticoagulant factors. But here, as balance, apparently this was quite constant through the development of healthy children. This was obtained with bleed screen because we know that when assessing hemostasis in children, it's more for bleeding disorders, but would require to be established also on thromboscreen and drug screen. Moving to anticoagulation. So the first paper that was published by Professor Segura and our team from the driving study showed that healthy volunteers taking a rivaroxaban. So over their stay over 24 hours, the patients were sampled, and we can see here how thromboregeneration changes over time. So these are the results obtained with drug screen. So for sure, the EDP little varies, but the peak changes, and of course, time to peak and lag time as well. One of the interesting results was that after 24 hours, so at trough level, the thromboregeneration was not equivalent to the one that was at time zero. So there is still an effect of the anticoagulant after 24 hours. One of the other results from this publication is that the variability among the individual is quite low, as high as expected, but not that high that we could expect also using thromboregeneration assays, showing that probably using ST Genesia helps standardizing and avoiding some variability. Then moving to publications from a team from Leipzig in Germany. Here is the first paper they've published in a research practice on thrombosis and hemostasis this year on 380 blood samples. So they were able to show how thromboregeneration measured with STG drug screen correlates with anti-10A or anti-2A tests, their usual ones. And apparently in their hands, thrombin peak and lag time and time to peak were the most sensitive parameters. One of their other results was that after 12 hours, so at almost trough levels, the strong regeneration was still inhibited. Moving to bleeding disorders. So the first paper that was published by a team in Oxford in UK, they showed that measuring thrombin generation in critically ill patients may help to decide or not to transfuse patients, and so identify the most critically ill patients that should require or would not require, again, blood transfusion. So it's not monitoring of the appropriateness of rebalancing hemostasis along the transfusion, is more again assessing prior to and probably prior to any event how we could transfuse those patients or not. Staying with liver disease patients, well, we know that within liver disease we often conclude to bleeding tendency because their PT and APTT are prolonged. Yet the study, well, we know also that thrombin generation is affected, and this was reproduced by a team from Switzerland again, Lorenzo Alberio, who showed that thrombin generation was increased actually in liver disease patients and was more and more increased along the severity of the cirrhosis. And for them, it was a good insight to maybe monitor better the hemostasis of liver disease patients, cirrhotic patients, with thrombin generation, because the usual coagulation markers as PT and APTT would tend to more bleeding tendency management, while here thrombin generation can help also making some decision making on management of anticoagulation in those patients if required. Moving to thrombotic disorders. So the first paper that I show here is again from the team from Switzerland of Professor Halberio. It is a case report from a woman that was not knowing that she was heterozygous factor V Leiden mutation. And actually, when she started taking some oral contraceptives, she asked for getting measured on thrombin generation because she is a woman within the team of Professor Halberio. And after measuring her thrombin generation under oral contraceptive, she realized how little thrombin generation was reduced when using thrombomodulin, and also how high was her thrombin generation profile from basal statement. So she stopped taking oral contraceptives, and she realized there again that the effect of thrombomodulin on this sample was quite low. So she decided to move and to change again her oral contraception to other contraceptives methods. And this case report is interesting because it shows that maybe in the clinical practice for individual patient management, thanks to individual measurements using ST Genesia, you can make some educated decision making for contraception decision with women. We all know that oral contraception can put women at risk of VTE. Moving on to these thrombotic profiles, here is a paper and a study done by Giuseppe Lippi. And so this study was done to evaluate the impact of hypertriglyceridemia, hyperbilirubinemia, and hemolysis on thrombin generation in human plasma. And here, yeah, they clearly showed that hypertriglyceridemia, hyperbilirubinemia, and hemolysis promote thrombin generation and promote the hypercoagulable state. And it was shown as well that it was not due to color itself, and we have other studies that were published and have posters presented on this matter, but really related to how these metabolic disorders, for example, can produce and induce hypercoagulable states. Finally, staying on cirrhotic patients, so earlier I told you that the team from Switzerland was initially looking into bleeding disorders because PT and APTT are prolonged within liver disease patients and cirrhotic patients. And they were able to show that in the opposite, it was more thrombotic. And this was confirmed by a team in Clermont-Ferrand, confirming that they had what they had obtained previously on their cohort with CAT, that ST Genesia detects hypercoagulability in patients with cirrhosis, and especially thanks to the reagent with thrombomodulin. And that's also that the ETP gradually increases throughout the severity of cirrhosis. Finally, moving to results that were shown at last ISTH again. So first a study from the UK showing that In patients with APS or SLE, how the difference between clinical phenotypes could be assessed also through swarm generation. Another poster that was quite interesting, showing how blood group could affect swarm generation results and could possibly also explain the quite large variability we have among healthy individuals. And the last poster that was shown at ISCH, you know that there were many posters and many talks about COVID-19. And so this was a poster shown by the same team in Switzerland from Lausanne, Professor Abelario. And so it was COVID-19 patients compared to healthy individuals and also COVID-19 patients with or without venous thromboembolism. And they were able to show that in those patients with undetectable anti-TNF activity, so it was not on patients with under UFH, the COVID-19 patients were having higher thrombogeneration generation profiles compared to healthy donors, and that the ones having had VTE were also having higher profiles compared to the patients that were without VTE. This is contrary to what was published by a team from Cambridge in the UK. In IGLH earlier this year. This team published with different results, and for them, the disease severity did not increase through instrument generation. But apparently, this team worked with samples that were anticoagulant, and they did not try to neutralize the heparin in the sample. Well, this is not what showed the team from Professor Mullier, and they always neutralized heparin in the samples prior to testing on ST-Genesia with SCG thrombosc. And for them, the ETP values were above the published reference ranges over the first week after ICU admission, showing that yes, there was hypercoagulability in those patients within the first week after the ICU admission. Thank you for your attention. And I wish you a very pleasant day.